Hi, as I cleaned my electronics workbench to prepare for the new year, I realized I had accumulated many unnecessary tools over time. With the new year underway, you might be considering getting into this hobby and purchasing some tools. It can be challenging to decide which tools to buy, but I can confidently say that there are a few tools on the market you should avoid. In this video, I will focus on the tool I believe you shouldn't purchase. The first tool on my list today are the soldering irons, particularly the common types you often find on the market. When I first started this hobby, like most people, I got myself a soldering iron like this one. They are usually very cheap and easy to find almost everywhere. The main issue with these soldering irons is that most of the time you can't create a proper solder joint. First, they take very long time to heat up, sometimes several minutes. On top of that, they usually struggle to maintain a consistent temperatures. You either get low temperatures that can't melt some of the solder at all, or excessively high temperatures that can damage the components. For example, I believe this particular soldering iron was overheating, which ended up burning up everything and creating a mess. At some certain point, I got very frustrated with all these issues. And I bought this one from Valor, and it's a well-known brand for soldering equipment, but it still didn't perform well. I had limited success with this unbranded blue one, but I still struggled with the certain tasks. The main issue is that not all solder melts at the same temperature. Unless you are working in a field where all your solders are standardized and you have tested the characteristic of a particular brand and model for a known type of solder work, you won't enjoy working the soldering irons. However, for most of us, that's almost never the case. What you need is a soldering iron that allows you to set the temperature, which is the most basic requirement. It doesn't need to be fancy, but adjustable temperature is essential if you don't want to end up hating this hobby. Let me tell you, it makes all the difference. If you are in the market for a soldering iron, I would recommend investing in a soldering station instead. For example, I have this soldering station. By the way, I should mention as a disclaimer that I am not affiliated with any brand or product. In fact, I am not even sure if this device has a brand to be affiliated with in the first place. So it's probably a clone of a clone. You know how it goes. It was quite cheap and definitely not the best soldering station out there. However, for hobby use, it's more than adequate. I'll include a link in the description if I can find one. Let's do a quick comparison to see how fast they'll heat up using a thermal camera. The red one is the weather blend, and the other one is the cheap soldering station. I have connected both to a wall outlet and will flip the switch so they'll start heating up at the same time. And they are heating up nicely. But as you can see, the cheap soldering station heats up significantly faster than the weller and maintains its temperature. If you encounter a different type of solder that requires a higher temperature, you can easily adjust it on the soldering station. However, with this type of soldering irons, that's not an option. And another thing is, if you take a look at the thermal images, the soldering iron from the soldering station is heating up on the tip of the soldering iron. And this type usually heats up in the middle, and it takes a while to heat up the top part. That's important because usually you need the tip to heat up. Otherwise, you cannot do a solder. So we definitely have a winner here, and this is the cheap soldering iron. The next thing on my list is the soldering consumables. After soldering iron, the most important aspect is selecting the right solder and the solder flux. I have tried many options over the years. While expensive solders and fluxes are, of course, excellent, I usually prefer not to spend too much money on them. If you are just starting out, you probably don't want to either. You rather allocate your budget to more fun stuff. However, don't just pick up random solder and flux. I purchased this thicker soldering wire. It wasn't lead-free, but generally, solders containing lead are much more forgiving during soldering. I bought a small spool of it, and it worked fine. It even ran out completely. However, I eventually stopped using it despite its performance. The reason was my concerns about the lead content. If you are not soldering often and have a proper ventilation, there is usually no issues using leaded solder. It's forgiving and provides a good soldering experience. However, as you likely know, lead is hazardous to your health. When it comes to solder flux, the same rule applies. Don't just pick up a random one like this. This particular flux was terrible for soldering, but I have to admit, it smelled amazing. Probably very dangerous for your health though. Recently, I started using this flux in a syringe from a certain brand. I am not sure what the brand, or I guess it's Kelly Shun. It worked well and I'll definitely order it again. Also, I tried a solder paste in a similar syringe form. However, don't buy these in a bulk unless you solder every day. They have a limited shelf life and need to be stored in a freezer to maintain its quality. The next mistake I made was this microscope. Back in the day, most electronics used deep packages. They were straightforward to work with, and I was often leaving them on the breadboard after I complete a project without bothering to make a PCB. While you can still order deep components today, they mostly outdated and lacked the advanced feature of modern chips. Nowadays, most components come in SMD packages, which are much harder to see under normal conditions. Additionally, they require designing and fabricating a suitable PCB. In upcoming videos, I'll share some of my PCB designs if I find them interesting enough. To deal with this challenge, I purchased a cheap microscope, assuming it would meet my needs. While the microscope does help you to see the parts, its camera quality is far from ideal. That said, it's better than those microscopes without any screen, which you connect to a monitor and try to work with them, which are the worst, I think. Besides their image quality, they are inconvenient and frustrating to use. This microscope, while somewhat functional, has several major drawbacks. First, you can't zoom enough to see the entire part if the package is relatively large. This is as far as it can get. The 5-inch screen doesn't help either, making it difficult to perform detailed tasks. The build quality is another issue, with a flimsy plastic base prone to damage. In one instance, I had to cover a crack in the base with a post-it note after it melted during a soldering session. For any microscope, I think a metal base should be a basic requirement. Well, on the bright side, this microscope has a useful feature. It comes with a built-in battery. This allows you to pick it up and move it around your workplace, offering some flexibility, despite its other shortcomings. Electronic microscopes lack perspective, which can be a significant drawback. If your budget permits, I strongly recommend investing in an optical microscope with a screen. However, those are often quite expensive. For now, I opted for this model, which, if I remember correctly, cost around $100. While it doesn't provide perspective, it performs reasonably well in most situations and comes with useful features like third end here and also a bar which lets you put your tools and such. Its resolution is 1080p, offers a decent image quality, not exceptional, but much better than the lower quality options available. And it lets me record videos. If you are looking for a microscope for basic soldering tasks, I suggest awaiting models with fewer features than this one. I'll add a link down in the descriptions if you are interested on this one as well. While I wish this microscope had a higher resolution like 4K for better video quality, it can be practical for hobby purposes. The last item on my list, which can be highly annoying, is the tweezers. I have had bad luck finding a decent pair and I am still on the lookout for the best one. For example, you can get set like this for quite cheap. At first they seem useful, but they quickly become frustrating. The metal they are made of isn't hard and they lose their shape quickly. This makes them useless for tasks like grabbing small SMD components. Take this one for instance. The tip is bent at some certain point, making it practically only useful for spreading a flux or something. Let me show you how bad these are. I'll grab one of them. By the way, I practically never use these. It looks decent at first, but even applying a small amount of force makes the tips misaligned, so they don't touch each other. So it looks fine first, but for example, if I put my finger and try to, let's say, bend it, then this will never work again. And there is no way to fix it either by bending it other way around. It looks fixed, but it's not gonna work well from now on. If you are going to get tweezers, make sure they are made of the hardest metal that you can possibly find and have the sharpest tips. I mention this because I have been quite annoyed by the poor quality tweezers. They work for a bit, but then they just become an annoyance. I found a decent one for a while ago. It had no brands, but it was usable. Unfortunately, I broke the tip by dropping it on the floor, and if I can find another, I'll get it. I'll include a link to this one, but since it's unbranded, I cannot guarantee the quality. Purchase at your own risk. Now that I have eliminated the major annoyances, soldering is no longer that frustrating experience for me. The truth is, I wanted to complete two small soldering tasks, which is why I decided to make this video. I've struggled a lot with the soldering in the past, and I wanted to share my experiences with this. The first task is one of my previous videos. The charging current for this port is a little bit too high and causing the batteries to overheat during charging. To fix this, I'll be replacing the programming resistor on the battery charger with one that allows for a slower pace. I'll record this part of the video under the microscope to make it easier for you to see the process better. I marked the programming resistor with a marker before starting. I did not have an 0603 resistor with the value I needed, so I will use an 0805 one instead. It's not ideal, but it will work. First, I usually try 350 degrees Celsius when I start on the random boards that I came across. Then I increase the temperature if the existing solder does not melt. Although the ability to make perfect, nice looking soldering on the small components is a skill, making it functional is not really a rocket science. So 350 degrees Celsius did not work, and I cranked it up to 450 degrees Celsius. However, it still did not melt. But I don't want to raise the temperature higher than that, because there is a chance I could damage the screen on this port, which is glued back of the PCB. And that's why I will add more solder on top to lower the melting point by creating an alloy. It is a little bit messy, but it should work. After this, I was able to remove the resistor at around 400 degrees Celsius. And this is the reason why I don't like using high temperatures. They usually mess up your board and you have to clean it thoroughly. I use ethanol with cotton tip to clean the burnt solder flux residue. And before soldering the new parts, I clean the remaining solder with a solder wick. Usually when using a soldering iron on small components, instead of melting the solder on the part, I apply flux to the location where I want to solder, and it holds the component in place. Then I melt a bit of solder on the tip of the soldering iron, hold the part with the tweezers, and touch the location where I want to apply solder. For me, this is the easiest method to solder smallest parts. Then I clean it again. It might be a bit excessive, but I've had bad experience with the leftover solder paste before. So I prefer to be safe rather than sorry. The second task involves the controller board from my Ender 3D printer. It broke when I pushed its limits while trying to print ABS filament. In the previous video, I discovered that the step motor controller here was faulty. To fix it, I'll use hot air soldering to replace the faulty component. When I did rework with a hot air gun, I covered the nearby components with Kapton tape to protect them from the heat. Another reason is, if you forget your airflow settings too high, it can send other small components flying after they have also melted. So it's definitely a useful technique. Then I cleaned the excess solder with the solder wick. I only add a very small amount of solder paste. If you add too much, it can create bridges. Then I roughly place it in the location as accurately as possible. If there is a small misalignment, you don't need to worry about it too much, because the surface tension will usually correct it for you. The rest is just holding the hot air gun. I usually use a low flow to have a better control over the soldering process. For this solder paste, I set my hot air gun to 350 degrees Celsius. If I have solder bleachers afterward, I simply add more solder flux and use the hot iron. Soldering flux is your friend, and don't be afraid to use it. Usually, just touching it with the hot iron is enough to resolve the bridges, unless you apply too much solder, in which case you'll need to use a solder wick again to remove the excess. And after I am done, I clean it with the ethanol and a cotton tip, and that's the final step.
This hobby can become expensive real quick, so I've shared the cheapest tools and consumables I could find that still perform well and don't cause frustration while soldering. If you have other suggestions to make soldering more enjoyable, please share them under the description. And if you like this video, don't forget to give a thumbs up, and see you next time.